Environment and Energy.
Oh, thank you, Mr. Speaker. Now, when the Coalition came to government, they inherited a basket case of an energy system from the Labor Party. We all remember the chaos and dysfunction that characterised the Rudd-Gillard-Rudd years. We remember prices going up each and every year. We remember Australian households being hit by a doubling of energy prices when Labor was in office, Mr. Speaker. We remember that great Athenian model of democracy, the Citizens' Assembly, Mr. Speaker. We remember the cash for clunkers, that great idea that was right up there with pink bats, Mr. Speaker. And we remember that dreaded carbon tax, which imposed a multi-billion dollar impost on Australian families and businesses, so much so that Labor had to spend billions of dollars of Australian taxpayers' money shoveling it out the door in one hit to the coal-fired generators, Mr. Speaker. You don't hear them talk about that much longer, much more, Mr. Speaker. Now, that was the Labor Party's record when they were in office, and we know that the member for Port Adelaide was quite embarrassed by it, because he put out a book called The Climate Wars, and he said, the truth is, we in Labor have sent too many mixed signals about climate policy. We've made mistakes in the design of our policies. And wait for it. He said Australian voters were determined to see the back of the Labor government, Mr. Speaker. That's the reality of what happened when Labor was in office. They also ignored the advice of their own market operators about the impact that the large export industry of gas from the east coast of Australia would have on the supply-demand dynamic on the east coast, basically driving prices up and reliability down, Mr. Speaker. That was the impact of their ignoring the energy market operators' advice in their own energy document, Mr. Speaker. So we came to government with that situation. What did we do? We abolished the carbon tax. Now, the member for Port Adelaide seems to challenge this issue about how much a saving went to Australian families. Well, the ABS said it was the single biggest drop in electricity prices ever recorded as a result of the abolition of the carbon tax. And I'm reading from an ACCC press release on the 28th of July 2015, which the ACCC believes that, given all the valuable information, the Commonwealth Treasury's estimated $550 cost savings to households is reasonable. Now, Mr. Speaker, that is the ACCC. And since that time, the Abbott and then the Turnbull governments have been taking action across the board to reduce power prices. Now, we've done a number of things. We've intervened in the gas market to ensure more gas goes to Australians before it's exported overseas. The ACCC have said that's seen a reported up to 50% drop in gas prices being made available into the market. That's good news for electricity users, because gas has been setting the price of electricity about twice as much as previously as some of the big coal-fired generators have come out of the system. But it's also good news for large energy users for whom gas is an important feedstock, and I'm talking about in the fertiliser industry, the chemical industry and paper industry and so forth. We've seen the wholesale electricity prices falling quite significantly. The wholesale electricity price is down about 25% this year. And last week, the wholesale spot price was around $68 a megawatt hour. This compared to $101 a megawatt hour the same time last year. That's what's happening as a result of the Turnbull government's interventions. We've also seen the network costs being cut. Rates of return when Labor was in office was about 8 to 10%, Mr. Speaker. We've now seen it fall to around 5 to 6%. That can be worth a couple of hundred dollars a year to households, Mr. Speaker. I took legislation through this parliament successfully, abolishing the limit of merits review, which has meant that no longer are the networks gaming the system. If Labor had done that, they would have saved Australian consumers $6.5 billion when they were in office, but they didn't do it, Mr. Speaker. It's been up to us to do it. And now we've got a new binding rate of return, which could also save significant costs to consumers. We're helping to get customers a better deal through the retail market. Since the Prime Minister's meeting with retailers last August, 1.6 million households on expired and default plans have been contacted and offered better deals. 500,000 households have moved off the expired and default plans to better deals, and another 1.3 million households have actually got better deals. Now, what we've also seen is the government's Energy Made Easy website, and for those who are listening on their radios across the country, energymadeeasy.gov.au is the government's comparator website, and when you go on it, you can actually compare your electricity bill to that being offered by other retailers and contracts. You can save millions of hundreds of dollars doing it that way, Mr. Speaker. And indeed, we've had over a million hits since the Prime Minister met with the retailers. And we saw electricity prices turn the corner on the 1st of July this year, when prices came down in Queensland, New South Wales and South Australia, and we're hoping to see the same thing happen when Victoria does a reset in January. Now, Mr. Speaker, we've also invested in important energy infrastructure. Most importantly, as the member for Eden-Monaro celebrated, welcomed, was delighted, was excited, was jumping from his chair with joy that the Turnbull government had actually delivering Snowy 2.0, Mr. Speaker, a major energy infrastructure project, pumped hydro scheme, which will be the largest of its kind in this part of the world, Mr. Speaker, that will be 2,000 megawatts, that will create 5,000 jobs, that will power 500,000 homes, Mr. Speaker. That's the reliability that we are bringing to the east coast of Australia that Labor never did. And we're investing in pumped hydro projects through ARENA and elsewhere in Kultana, in the Upper Spencer Gulf, in the member for Grays electorate, Mr. Speaker, in South Australia, in Kidston, in Queensland, Mr. Speaker. And we've identified 14 high priority or highly probable pumped hydro projects and hydro projects across Tasmania, Mr. Speaker, to help Tasmania become the battery of the nation. And we've talked about a second interconnector to provide Tasmanians both energy security but also to provide more power into the east coast of Australia. But, Mr. Speaker, all this work is having an impact. But it also leads us to the National Energy Guarantee, which I'm so pleased my colleagues endorsed today, to take to the next stage when the states will hopefully sign on before the end of October, Mr. Speaker. Because the states now have no excuse. The states now have no excuse. They asked our party room to endorse it, and we did. And we did. Now, the National Energy Guarantee was put together by the independent experts. We'll drive electricity bills down, together with our other policies, by $550, the average household, and wholesale prices 20%, which could be worth millions of dollars to the large energy users, but also has the enormous support of industry, business, energy consumer groups. Listen to what Energy Consumers Australia said. The final detailed design of the National Energy Guarantee, which includes updated modelling, which confirms that the guarantee can deliver much-needed savings for households and businesses. Mr. Speaker, that was the Energy Consumers. What about Queensland Chamber of Commerce and Industry, representing more than 400,000 Queensland small businesses? And I'm speaking to the member for Dawson, because the member for Dawson has many businesses that would actually be involved with the Chamber of Commerce and Industry. At the end of the day, the National Energy Guarantee promises what we've all been waiting for, a downward pressure on electricity prices and policy certainty. In New South Wales, 190-year-old Chamber of Business Commerce, 19,000 businesses, it said Australia can't afford any more flip-flopping on energy policy. We need to get the national energy policy that provides certainty, improves energy affordability and security and reduces emissions before the end of this year. Similar endorsements in Victoria, in Tasmania, Mr. Speaker, and across South Australia. We've seen BHP, we've seen Rio Tinto, we've seen Aurora, we've seen Dow Chemical, we've seen the National Farmers Federation, seen BlueScope, we've seen Energy Users Association, the Manufacturing Australia, we've just seen Australian Industry Group, Chemistry Australia, representing a $40 billion industry, the likes of 3M, Dow, Ixom, Qantas, Orica, Mr. Speaker. These are the companies that employ millions of Australians, blue-collar workers, millions of Australians. They are imploring us to support the National Energy Guarantee. They say listen to the experts. They say put aside your politicking and your posturing. Get behind a policy that puts consumers first. Get behind a policy that maintains our international competitiveness. Get behind a policy which will reduce the bills of Australian families. That's why the Turnbull government is getting on with the National Energy Guarantee. That's why the Turnbull government can deliver lower power prices.
The time has expired, and I call the member